is a holiday weekend, as many of you know, and as those who are not here most certainly have figured out. Sadly, it has become one of those interchangeable long weekend holidays that have come to signal either the beginning or end of swimsuit and flip-flop season. And the original intent of the holiday may have been forgotten. I admit, I often have to stop and think about which is which. Okay, when I was in high school, when I was in the high school marching band, we would be in the Memorial Day parade and stop and play taps in the cemetery, and that was in the spring, so Labor Day must be the one in the fall. Yes, it is the Labor Day weekend, and upon reflecting on the current employment situation, I believe the wage gap, the income gap, and the wealth gap have escalated beyond an economic issue, beyond a social issue, and have now become a moral issue. And as a moral issue, we in this faith community should be concerned. Before I get to some of my concerns, let's look at how Labor Day came to be in these United States. Labor Day is much more than a symbolic end to summer. Created by the labor movement in the late 19th century, Labor Day pays tribute to the contributions and achievements of American workers and became a federal holiday in 1894. According to history.com, the holiday originated during one of American labor history's most dismal chapters. In the late 1800s, at the height of the Industrial Revolution in the United States, the average American worked 12-hour days and 7-day weeks in order to eke out a basic living. Despite restrictions in some states, children as young as 5 or 6 toiled in mills, factories, and mines across the country, earning a fraction of their adult counterparts' wages. People of all ages, particularly the very poor and recent immigrants, often faced extremely unsafe working conditions with insufficient access to fresh air, sanitary facilities, and breaks. As manufacturing increasingly supplanted agriculture as the wellspring of American employment, labor unions, which had first appeared in the late 18th century, grew more prominent and vocal. They began organizing strikes and rallies to protest poor conditions and compel employers to renegotiate hours and pay. So, in the grand scheme of things, Labor Day becoming official was not that long ago, just really 5 years before this very church was founded. While abysmal working conditions are rarer and fewer 5-year-olds are punching a time clock, the escalating economic inequality and shrinking middle class in our country is evidence of a modern labor dilemma, the inability of a huge number of workers to secure a living wage, and this in turn leads to an ever-widening wealth gap. I believe that for many people in my generation entering the workforce, a job waiting tables or in retail was a typical start. My first real job in high school was waiting tables at Frisch's Big Boy restaurant in Florence, Kentucky. You may remember that down here the franchise was Kipp's and out on the West Coast it was Bob's. While I often cannot remember what I had for lunch yesterday, I do remember that in 1977 the price of a cup of coffee at Frisch's was 35 cents. This was back in the day when people would sit at a counter and drink a cup of coffee, maybe chat with those next to them rather than stare at a phone. And takeout cups were small, medium, and large, not short, tall, and pseudo-Italian. Just for grins, I Googled the average price of a cup of Java today. It's $2.70. 7¾, almost 8 times the amount it was when I waited tables. While on the computer, I went to Realtor.com and looked at homes in the same neighborhood and similar to the one my family lived in until I was in 6th grade. As it turns out, they're exactly 8 times what my parents paid when I was a toddler. My parents bought this home on one salary, my dad's, and he had nothing more than a high school education. While the cost of both coffee and homes has risen at least 8 times since my youth, the minimum wage has not. The minimum wage in 1977 was $2.30. Not that I made minimum wage, mind you. Since I was a tipped employee, I made half that, $1.15 an hour. But if the minimum wage had increased, like the price of a cup of coffee, it would be today $18.40. It is $7.25. I'm often shocked at the outrage and vitriol I see on social media when people discuss raising the minimum wage. Some people seem to take it as a personal affront that because they worked very hard for their salaries, other people shouldn't want to make enough to provide food and shelter for their families. Myths die hard. It is no longer true, if it ever was, that if you simply work hard enough, you are guaranteed to be successful. Americans love their Horatio Alger stories about, quote, impoverished boys and their rise from humble backgrounds to lives of middle-class security and comfort through hard work, determination, courage, and honesty, end quote. But today, in America, as elsewhere, there are plenty of hardworking, courageous, and honest people who cannot get ahead. There is a saying that goes, if hard work guaranteed a financial success, every woman in Africa would be a millionaire. It's not fair, the offended say. I had to work years to be making my current salary. Yes, you're right, you did, but it's not about fairness. It's about common sense and basic human decency. A person working full-time should be able to afford to feed, clothe, and house their family. If it were about fairness, this country would not have been built on the backs of people kidnapped from another continent and brought here to work not only for free, but as slaves. If it were about fairness, blacks would not be making 75% as much as whites, and women wouldn't be making 83% of what men do. If it were about fairness, Americans in the top 1% wouldn't be averaging over 40 times more income than the bottom 90%. Does anyone really believe they work 40 times as hard or as long than other people? According to research by the National Low Income Housing Coalition in June of this year, there is no state in these United States where a full-time minimum wage worker can afford a two-bedroom apartment. Now, I see people complain that calculation is assuming that people won't be willing to spend more than 30% of their income on housing in case, you know, they want to do things like have clothes and food in a savings account. And that's fair. Back in the day, I certainly spent more than 30% of my income on rent. But I did my own math. And for someone whose interests lie in theology and show tunes, math is a challenge. Making minimum wage in Dallas, $7.25 times 40 hours a week, is $290. 290 times 4 weeks in a month is $1,160. The average price for a Dallas apartment is $1,040 a month. So, even if you didn't have to pay taxes on your minimum wage job, which you do, and you've got to keep the entire $1,160, you would have $120 a month left over after rent to clothe and feed your family. Your rent would be 90% of your pre-tax income. Even if you made the average wage in DFW, which is $24.21, an average apartment would be a full third of your pre-tax income. According to CareerBuilder.com, 78% of full-time workers said they live paycheck to paycheck, up from 75% last year. Overall, 71% of all U.S. workers said they're now in debt, up from 68% only a year ago. And while 46% said their debt is manageable, 56% said that they were in over their heads. A popular fast food corporation recently attempted to help their employees budget wisely. "You can have almost anything you want as long as you plan ahead and save for it," the employees were assured. The suggested budget, which was published by the company on a website, but has mysteriously vanished after the inevitable criticism, left room open for a second job to help make ends meet. It budgeted $20 a month for health care, $0 for heating, and $600 for rent. Apparently, a third job would be needed during the winter or if one gets sick. Stories are legion about employees at large retailers applying for public assistance even as they work full-time without benefits. The corporations ask incredulously why they would willingly pay any more than they have to. They claim it doesn't make financial sense. I would ask, when did it become morally acceptable to have a business plan that employs people full-time at a rate where they can't provide for their families? These types of instances may be why you've probably heard talk of a living wage. A living wage is simply a wage that is high enough to maintain a normal standard of living. Not extravagant, not luxurious, normal. Of course, this amount will vary depending on where you live and how many are in your family. Helpfully, at livingwage.mit.edu, and I know some of you will ask, so I'll repeat it, livingwage.mit.edu, they have broken all this down for us, showing various family configurations and typical annual expenses. In Dallas County, for instance, a living wage for a single adult is listed at $10.94, a poverty wage at $5, and of course the minimum wage at $7.25. Another example on the MIT website is, for a family of two adults with three children, that both adults would need to make $16.93 for a living wage, which is more than double the minimum wage. Of course, there are those who will tell you people making too little to get an education. Well, tell the people who are making too little to get an education and get a better paying job. Well, the fact is that countless people have gotten an education, have tens of thousands of dollars in tuition debt, and still aren't making a living wage. A millennial's chances of earning more than their parents is now just 50%. That's a drop from 92% of children born in 1940. Plus, once those people have moved on to college or to a better job, what about the people who replaced them in their former jobs? Are they not supposed to be able to feed their families? As I said earlier, these problems have escalated beyond an economic issue, beyond a social issue, and are now a moral issue. And as a moral issue, we in this faith community can be doing more. I hope drawing your attention to the severity of the problem this morning is a first step. The excerpt I read earlier is from the UUA Statement of Conscience, Escalating Economic Inequality. The statement lists what we as individuals can do and what our congregation can do. I know all this seems overwhelming and like an uphill battle. Politicians continue to argue that paying people fairly costs jobs, not mentioning that instead of cutting jobs, they could shave the record profits being funneled to the 1%. St. Louis minimum wage just reverted to $7.70 from $10. The governor argued that giving people a raise would take money out of people's pockets. Corporations are not content to only pay minimum wage. We now have to check out our own groceries, pump our own gas, and check ourselves in at the airport and doctor's office. Cutting these jobs clearly isn't because these workers were making huge salaries. It's to increase record profits and provide bonuses for those at the top. The statement of conscience, which you can find on the UUA website, begins with these words. Quote, challenging extreme inequality locally and globally is a moral imperative. As a pragmatic faith, we are committed to working to change economic and social systems with the goal of equitable outcomes of life, dignity, and well-being experienced by all. The escalation of income and wealth inequity undergirds many injustices that our faith community is committed to addressing, including economic injustice, mass incarceration, migrant injustice, climate change, sexual and gender injustice, and attacks on voting rights, end quote. Some of the items listed in the Statement of Conscience of what a moral economic system would include are equal pay for equal work and elimination of the racial, ethnic, and gendered wealth gap, a minimum wage indexed for inflation that provides a living wage with benefits regardless of disability or ability, and wages that honor the work of hands as well as that of minds. Our UU principles of justice, equity, and compassion in human relations drive us to work for healthier and more equitable economic systems. These labor issues have again become a moral issue in our country that begs to be addressed. By supporting companies that respect working people and pay fairly, by supporting politicians that respect working people and seek to pass legislation to protect us, and by working to ensure that all workers receive not only a minimum wage, but a living wage, we can build communities where everyone is supported in living healthy, safe, and sustainable lives. Amen.